look for an umbrella for the camera.
Do you like my makeshift?
I like that. Steven, you are good?
Excellent.
And I'm in contact with remote HQ, okay. AKA Greg.
I'm a minute late. Happy Independence Day weekend. God's blessings as we gather for 4th of July weekend, and we gather in God's house, in my father's house, under his roof for worship this morning. It is so wonderful to have you here on this warm July day, and God's continued blessings be upon you and your families as we continue our worship and continue praising God. This is the one time we're going to ask you to stand as we do the Pledge of Allegiance together. The colors are to my right, your left, and let's say the Pledge of Allegiance together. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Please be seated. I'm going to invite Adam and Isabel Dougherty to come forward at this time. I'm going to stand over here. You guys remain over there. Mr. and Mrs. Dougherty. That is just such a wonderful thing to say. Woohoo! Director of Christian Education, Adam Dougherty, is with us. He just came in from Virginia, and Isabel and Adam were recently married, and we are so joyful to have them here starting their ministry with us. We will have an official installation and commissioning later, but this is your first Sunday among us, and we wanted to just say a few words over both of you as you start your ministry. And the words are taken from Psalm chapter 33. As we begin our service, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Psalm 33 says, "Shout for joy in the Lord, O you righteous. Praise befits the upright. Give thanks to the Lord with the lyre." That's an instrument. "Make melody to him with the harp of 10 strings. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully on the strings with loud shouts, for the word of the Lord is upright, and all his work is done in faithfulness. He loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the steadfast love of the Lord." Adam and Isabel, as we gather together with your family in Christ here at Salem, continue to make a joyful noise to the Lord. Continue to praise him with your actions, your words, your mind, your heart, your body, hands, and feet. And may God's blessings continue to be upon you as you bring a joyful noise to our congregation, and as our congregation supports you with love and support as well. God be with you always and forever. Amen. Welcome, Adam and Isabel. Woohoo!
All right, well, good morning.
You are
not
now.
Quite yet. There I am. Well, good morning and welcome to worship. Welcome to Salem. It's wonderful to see you all this morning. It's wonderful to be in your presence. If you're joining us online, please go to our website at www.salemorange.com and click on Sunday Services if you'd like to download the lyrics for this morning's worship music. You can also leave an offering through our website and even RSVP for next Sunday's outdoor service if you'd like to join us live next week here on the lawn. As we begin our service today, let's get our hearts and our minds focused on God and ready to worship him. Let's pray together. Would you please bow your heads? Let's bow our heads and pray together. Dear Lord, on this glorious day, on this 4th of July weekend of family cookouts and dazzling fireworks displays, let us not forget the reason for it all. Over 200 years ago, when our forefathers hammered out their Declaration of Independence, they first acknowledged their need for your help and guidance. And so, Lord, on this beautiful day in the midst of the sun and the frolic, help us to remember that our independence from tyranny is based on our absolute dependence on you. Lord God Almighty, grant that all the people of this land may have the grace to maintain our liberties in righteousness and peace through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever and ever. Amen. All right, let's sing together. Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see the beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Let's sing together. And here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, King of all days, so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. And here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. Let's sing together. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Amen. Amen. What a wonderful way to start the morning.
Let's keep that up.
Sing wonderful.
Wonderful, so wonderful is your unfailing love.
Your cross has spoken mercy over me. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no heart can fully know how glorious, how beautiful you are. Oh, beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul must say. Powerful, so powerful, your glory fills the skies. Your mighty works displayed for all to see. The beauty of your majesty awakes my heart to sing. How marvelous, how wonderful you are. Oh, beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul. To your wonders anew, you captured my heart with this love, because nothing on earth is as beautiful as you. Let's sing that together. You opened my eyes to your wonders anew, you captured my heart with this love, because nothing on earth is as beautiful as you. Oh, beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul must say. Oh, beautiful one I love, beautiful one I adore, beautiful one my soul must say. You opened my eyes to your wonders anew, you captured my heart with this love, because nothing on earth is as beautiful as you. Amen, amen. Well, now we have some special announcements from Jana Ryland, who is making her way up here, who was kind enough to come early this morning and get these announcements.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome again to worship. We're so glad that you've joined us today, and I just have a couple quick announcements. First of all, if you need prayer, like we all always do, please email prayer@salemorange.com, and our prayer team would love to be praying for you. We can even pray over the phone with you. Again, if you need prayer, please email prayer@salemorange.com. Second, Salem is always looking for ways to help our community. If we can shop for you or run errands or do anything at all to help you right now, please contact us. Again, email deacons@salemorange.com. We would love to help. Again, that's deacons@salemorange.com. Third, our ARC program fund, which provides our community by supplementing rent, providing groceries, gas cards, many other resources to help people in need, and we are currently running low on those. So if you're considering or looking for a way to help the community, please consider donating to this fund. And last but not least, we'd like to thank you for contributing your tithes to Salem. The church is only able to function because of your generous offerings, and so we truly appreciate you making your tithe to Salem a priority. God bless you all.
And now we're going to go ahead and take some time and collect our gifts and offerings. But before we do, let's pray. Let's pray together. Let's pray over them. Father, bless these tithes and offerings. With them, we worship you. You who have molded into one our nation, drawn from the peoples of many lands, grant that as the grains of wheat become one bread and the many grapes one cup of wine, so we may before all others be instruments of your peace. It's through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let's sing God Bless America.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with a light from above. Let's sing together. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with foam, God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, my home, sweet home. Let's sing that together. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with a light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with foam, God bless America, my home, sweet home. God bless America, my home, sweet home. Amen.
While I adjust my headset, if you are following along, we're going to be taking a look at Acts chapter 3 today. Acts chapter 3, starting with verse 1. If you want to pull that out in your Bible, or if you want to look it up, we're going to take a look at Acts chapter 3. God's grace, God's mercy, and God's peace be to you, my brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord and risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Well, today's a different day than last Sunday, isn't it? The sun's out, it's hot, and when I'm done with my hour-long sermon, we'll see how far we go. But I know that God has given us clear and blue skies. Last week it was nice and cool, and so thank you all for being here. Just a couple updates before we get into the message. Bob Frunz has received his freedom from earthly life and has entered eternal life. And so family and I will be planning a service this week. We'll get the word out. It is going to be a very small service, just primarily for family members, and then we will stream the video out and have that available for those who would like to watch that as well and celebrate Bob's life. Well, Acts chapter 3. Let's get right into it, shall we? Acts chapter 3, and I'm going to be stopping a number of different times as we walk through this, just to see not only the historical application or the historical understanding, but also the practical application for what it means to us today. One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer at 3 in the afternoon. Now, I want to just stop and say, in some Bibles it might say the ninth hour. That's roughly 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Going back, for those who might have any biblical history or knowledge, what else happened at the ninth hour, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, on one Good Friday? Jesus proclaimed from the cross, "It is finished. Your sins are forgiven is the understanding. And so Luke, the medical doctor, the historical writer of this book, gives us that understanding that on the ninth hour, at the ninth hour, same time Jesus says it is finished, Peter and John go to the temple to pray. Now, there were a number of different times that people would go. There was a time for sacrifice, and there were times for prayer, and this was one of them at 3 p.m. And I love how that rolls together with this text here, that Jesus, who proclaims freedom, who proclaims liberty, who proclaims forgiveness of our sins from sin and Satan and the power of the devil, reminds us that we have independence. We have freedom. We have God's forgiveness. And Peter and John, as they are walking to the temple at the ninth hour at 3 p.m. for prayer, we pick up at verse 2. Now a man who was lame from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. 40 years old, the Bible tells us this man was. For 40 years, he'd been begging at the gate Beautiful. And for anyone who's ever been to Jerusalem, or anyone who's ever looked at Jerusalem, that Beautiful gate is no longer there. It was destroyed back with the sacking of the temple in 70 AD. But the background behind it, it was a double entrance door, double door, 75 feet tall, covered in not rich Corinthian leather, but rich Corinthian brass. And it was called Beautiful. And it was outside the temple proper, and so beggars and people who needed assistance would sit there and be brought there. And this man had been lame for 40 years. Can you imagine begging for 40 years? Can you imagine the idea of relying on someone else's gifts and alms and blessings for 40 years? I know we take a look at homelessness and we interact with Charity on Wheels, and that is something so key, but each one of us are beggars at the gate of Beautiful. Each one of us come to God and say, God, I need you. I need you so much. Please heal me. Please bless me. Please give me your mercy and peace. Each one of us are like this beggar. But here, in this particular instance, he had been coming to the gate and relying on the grace of others. And when he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said, look at us. Look at us. Look. Look at us. So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. I don't know about you, but whenever I'm at the beach or in a place where somebody is asking me for money, or down at the Circle, the Plaza, or I'm walking around different places, there's times where I'm on a mission and I just forget to make eye contact, or I sometimes intentionally bypass them. And that's kind of human nature. We kind of walk by and don't pay attention when somebody is in need. But Peter and John stop. They say, look at us. I see you. I see your needs. I see that you are a human. I see that you are a child of God, God's creation. Look. Look at us. I think nowadays, as we're looking at the world around us, with all the different protests that are going on, with all the different injustices that claim our attention, there's sometimes we just want to hide and not look. And yet we've got the power of God, the Holy Spirit who dwells in us says, look, look into the needs of those around you. It might be looking into the needs of your home and saying, what do I as a follower of Christ need to do? Or what do I need to do on my campus or in my school or in my collegial workplace? What do I need to do in my community? Look, look with the eyes of God, because God's the one who's driving you forward. God's the one who gives you the ability to be able to accomplish incredible things. Verse 6, then Peter said, silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. How many of you know what your name means? Anybody know what their name means? Have you ever looked it up? Adam, what is yours?
Man.
Man.
Or red clay, of red clay.
Of red clay, Adam, man, of red clay. Okay, so the Garden of Eden must have been red clay.
Yeah.
Man, anybody else? Anybody want to share? Yes, Nicole. Victory of people, excellent. Nicole means victory of people. Wow, anybody else? All right, seeing none, take a look at what your name means after the service. Don't Google it right now. Stay focused. But take a look at what your name means. Mine means spear of fame or famous warrior. That's when I looked it up. That's what my name means. Not Pastor, Roger. That's what that name means. Pastor is shepherd, and that's one of the reasons why I always say, please call me pastor, because it reminds me that God has placed me in here to shepherd and to serve the people of Salem in this community. Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Peter uses that term specifically because in Jesus' time, people were always making fun of him. What good can come out of Nazareth? What good can this man do? And yet, Peter waves it as a banner and says, Jesus Christ and the power and presence of God is with us. Brothers and sisters, I know that a number of us are going through difficult times, medically, financially, spiritually, emotionally, relationally, whatever it might be. Sometimes we say we have to rely on our own name and our own works and our own abilities. But God reminds us, when we wave the banner of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, incredible, amazing, miraculous things happen. Maybe not right away. Maybe not the way we expect them. But our mindset change, our hearts change, our hands, our attitudes change. When we look to God and say, all right, Lord, I don't understand, but I'm going to wave your banner. I'm going to pledge my allegiance to Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Earlier, we pledged allegiance to the flag and our country and the freedoms and liberties that we hold so dear. But in our life, in addition to that here on earth, in our life for eternity, waving the banner of Jesus Christ of Nazareth and following him. We might not agree with everything he says. We might not agree with everything that's found in the Bible. But when we say we trust you and we pledge allegiance to you, that is who we will follow. And we might be foolish in doing it. But God reminds us that we might be foolish, but in Christ we are strong and courageous and wise. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. Luke is a medical doctor, and he uses this specifically. It's the only place in the Bible where this terminology is found. And the feet and the ankles, in the way it's said in Greek, reminds us that this was totally a miraculous transformation. It's as if the sockets were put back in place. His feet, his ankles were rejoined together, and after 40 years of begging, he was miraculously healed. Wasn't just like breaking an ankle, breaking a leg, getting that healed back together. It was out of whack. And Lisa, I know you're watching at home. God's blessings as you heal from your fall. And anyone else, God will put you and mend you back together the way He wants to. But this idea of mending, of putting back the pieces, God does that for us. We who are lame in life, in our relationships, in our spirituality, in our emotional baggage, God takes that and puts us back together according to His will. He says, walk. And sure enough, that's exactly what the lame man did. How many of you like to walk? All right. How many of you don't like to walk? All right. Excellent. Yesterday, there was a group of us that decided to go out for an early morning walk. How many of you have ever been up to Robber's Roost in Santiago Oaks Park? All right. I know a number of bicyclists have. And so we decided that we were going to walk up there to Robber's Roost. And sure enough, it was comfortable going up there temperature-wise until we hit this long incline. And it felt like 10 miles, but it was only, what, about a mile up or so. And sure enough, we lost some of our group who didn't make it up. But we made it up to Robber's Roost. We made it up to the flag, and then we decided to keep going. And we kept walking. And me, of course, who was so out of shape, said, oh, yeah, I can do this. It'll be downhill from here. And as we traversed chutes and mountain goat, as we walked back and saw Peter's Canyon and the backside of Villa Park Dam, as we waved to our Salem families on the backside of the Villa Park Dam, and as we continued walking around, my knees started barking at me. And they were in pain. And this morning when I woke up, I felt very lame in more ways than one, but especially around my knees because they were out of whack, out of shape. They hadn't really been doing that kind of walking and I felt lame. Well, this will hopefully heal. But in our lives, there are times when our bodies feel weak and out of shape. Or maybe our spiritual lives feel weak and out of shape. And God says, come to me, all who are weary, all who are lame, and I will have you leap for joy. I will have you leap in the Lord. That's exactly what happens here. He jumped to his feet. The Greek says he leaped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and leaping and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. Brothers and sisters, is a miraculous story, but it's one that's told over and over in the lives of each one of us. We might not have the physical lameness that this man had, but we are all wounded. We are all broken. We are all lame in some way. Physically, mentally, emotionally, probably not, but spiritually, we can feel lame at times. And God comes to us and says, I heal you. Look at me. I am your Lord and God and Savior. I heal you. And our response is to leap up in joy and say, yes, Lord. Thank you for the freedom that you give us through your grace, the independence that you give us of knowing you as our Lord and Savior, and the liberty that we have of following God, Jesus Christ, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Give me liberty or give me death is a revolutionary saying. But God says, I give you liberty and life in my name. Don't be lame. Let me say that again. Don't be lame. Leap in joy, knowing that the Lord your God loves you, heals you, saves you, and is with you always. In his name, amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, I'm going to invite those who are assisting with communion to make their way forward and to glove up. And today, as we walk into this, as we go from the message to receiving God's presence to heal us physically and spiritually within us, wafer, which is God's body, wine, which is God's blood, given to us and spoken to us through the word of God. We are lame spiritually, but God says you are healed spiritually and eternally. And we look forward to the feast that God gives to us here on earth together as the community of Christ, but also that coming day when we too will be in heaven in the Lord and we will be healed of all of our afflictions. But until then, we gather together as the body of Christ and we leap and praise God. We walk to his temple courts and we gather together, leaping and walking and jumping and praising God. That's our response as God comes to us and says, you are healed. Let us continue to gather together. Let us continue to walk together, arm in arm with our brothers and sisters in Christ, leaping for joy and for praising God. God be with you as you continue to walk in his name and in his presence. And today, as we receive the body and blood of Christ, we will have our gloved, masked communion assistants walking around. And we're going to drop the wafer in your hand. So please hold that out clearly for us, a good target to aim at. And then we'll also distribute the wine cups as well. And if you want gluten or grape juice, please just, gluten-free wafer or grape juice, please make that well known to the communion distributors. And now, as we go to God, let's say a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly, most gracious Father, we thank you that you have abundantly blessed us. You have taken our broken bodies, minds, hearts, and souls, and you have said, I have forgiven them all on the cross when I said, it is finished. And so, Lord, because of that, we can leap for joy and praise your name and gather together and be able to go out and heal the needs of those around us in our homes, in our neighborhoods, in our communities and beyond. Allow us, Lord, to walk with your power and your presence as you lead us forward. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And Lord, we thank you for allowing Bob to be with you in the Lord now. Be with Bob Friends and his family as he celebrates eternal life. Lord, we also ask a blessing upon Lisa as she fell, and upon Paul as he cares for her. And Lord, there are many prayer requests that are upon our hearts and minds. We pray for Kayla, who just came through our prayer chain yesterday, and a number of others who are on our hearts and minds, those that are known to all of us and those that are known only in our hearts and minds. Lord, we lift them up to you, knowing that you heal the broken and you affirm the afflicted and you give grace to the graceless of all of us. And you bring us your peace. So watch over us and be with us and lead us as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now, brothers and sisters, the very body and blood of Christ is going to be shared with you. And on the night when he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you." And in the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Receive my blood, this new covenant given for you and shed for you. And may the very body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and preserve you, keep you strong and steadfast, always and forever. Amen." I know last week we said as soon as you receive your communion, go ahead and depart. We're going to say, hey, once you receive communion, stay and continue singing. And when you are comfortable, if you want to depart right after communion, fine. If you want to stay and sing, fine. We just encourage everyone to maintain physical distancing from one another. We might be separated physically, but in Christ we are together as the body of Christ. So God bless you as you receive his grace and forgiveness. Amen.
Take me to the pastures green. You restore my soul. Lead me in the path of righteousness. And you prepare a table in the presence of my foes. And you anoint my head and my cup overflows, and surely forever. And whom shall I be afraid? Presence of my foes, and you anoint my head, and my cup it overflows, and surely in the house of the Lord forever.